فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحوم كالطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household without exception, all his companions without exception. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every one of us. My beloved brothers and sisters, something that's extremely important for us to know is there were very few fortunate companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who were actually told that you are from paradise. We know the 10 common ones known as Al-Ashara Al-Mubashareena Bil-Jannah, the 10 who were given this glad tiding all at once. Then there were the others, those who took part in the Battle of Badr, they were given signs towards that. And there were some who were actually told you were or you are from among those in Jannah. Bilal ibn Rabah radiallahu anhu was told by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that I heard your footsteps in Jannah. And there were so many ways to know that this companion is definitely in Jannah. There was one such companion who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man sarrahu an yanzura ila rajulin min ahli al-jannah falyanzur ila Abdullah ibn Salaam." Whoever would like to see a companion or a man from amongst the men of Jannah should look at this man. Who was he? Abdullah ibn Salaam. So today we will spend a few minutes, inshallah, speaking about this wonderful, beautiful, extremely knowledgeable, pious individual and how he came to Islam and his history. His name was Al-Hussain Ibn Salaam. This was prior to him accepting Islam. He was one of the chief rabbis of the Jewish community in Medina Munawwara, part of Banu Qaynuqa'. Banu Qaynuqa' were part of the Jewish people, the tribes that were there, Banu Nadir, etc. So he was one of the chiefs of Banu Qaynuqa, very knowledgeable. He was such a pious man. He was born, according to the narrations, 20 years prior to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which means 20 years before the year of the elephants. Now, the Jewish people had heard that there will be a messenger sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala coming to a certain type of land, a desert land with some rocks, and it will have palms and so on. So they were looking for that type of land. They found some in Khaybar, so they camped there. They found some in Medina Munawwara, so they camped there. So they were divided in different areas, hoping that perhaps we who have read the previous scriptures or the Torah, those who know it well, we will find this messenger. We will be from among the followers, the first followers of this new or this final messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Among them was this beautiful man, lovely person. They say, according to some of the historians, that he was from the lineage of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, the people used to respect him tremendously. The people of Banu Qaynuqa, not only them, but even those who were not Jewish, the Christians and the others, he was a just man. When anyone stands for justice, the entire humanity will respect the person. They will love him. They will know that this with this person, you will not be oppressed in any way. Similar is Najashi. He was a Christian man, but the Muslimin, in fact, the Prophet ﷺ praised him to say, when you go there, to his companions, when you go there, you will find a man, he will be a Christian ruler, but he's a just man. He won't oppress you at all. So this is a teaching that we learn from the life of Al-Hussain ibn Salam. He was a just person, loved by all, and at the same time, he was always respected by the people. It is said that he was so pious that he divided his day into three. A third of the day he would spend in the synagogue, you know, the place of worship. And he would address people, speak to them, meet to the needs of the people, guide them and so on. That was one third of the day. Another third of the day, he had his business. What was his business? He was a farmer. So he had a garden where he used to plant dates and so on. He used to go there for a third of the day. And another third of the day, he used to sit towards the evening with the Torah. And he used to read it repeatedly and he used to look into it. And he had a particular topic of interest in the Torah. What was it? It was the qualities that were made mention of the next prophet. He used to read it. He used to picture it. He used to make a dua to Allah always. Oh Allah, give me the life to see this Prophet. Give me a life to follow him. Give me a life to be able to support him, to be able to stand with him from the persecutions that would reach him. Because obviously the Anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophets, they have been told that you will be persecuted by your people. In fact, the hadith says, those who are persecuted the most are the Prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then those who are closest to the Prophets are persecuted similarly. So if you want to know whether you are close to the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the Prophets in terms of the work that you are doing, you need to ask yourself, am I persecuted? If you are seriously persecuted, perhaps you are on the right path. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. People today look at some of the Muslimin as being persecuted and they think, look, these people are really bad and terrible. Some of the Muslims, they lose courage. They lose hope. They start thinking, when is this going to stop? But I was speaking to a Christian a few days ago who was telling me the same thing, that you people are very bad. I said, what is the sign of it? He says, the sign of it is you people are persecuted everywhere you go. I told him, my brother, what religion do you follow? He said, I'm a Christian. Do you agree that Jesus was more persecuted than I was? He said, yes, without a doubt. I said, there you are. If being persecuted had to actually mean that you are on the wrong path, then Jesus was on the most wrong path. And I wouldn't say that being a Muslim. So I think you need to get your facts right. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. My beloved brothers and listeners, do you know that in essence, when a person is persecuted, the amount of contentment that he has in his heart would actually determine his closeness to Allah. So if you are persecuted and you become angry, you become upset, you become sad, you become depressed, perhaps it may be the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if you are a person who's persecuted so much, you've lost wealth, you've lost perhaps some of your health, you might have lost something greater, and you are so content, you are so happy, subhanAllah, that's a sign of acceptance from Allah. It's a sign of closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not test us with tests that are too difficult for us to pass. And at the same time, may He keep us content with whatever comes in our direction. Ameen. So he used to read for a long time and long hours every evening. And he used to picture within his own mind that inshallah a day will come when I will be the supporter of this messenger. And as time passed, he heard, as I said, he made a dua, oh Allah, give me a long life. He heard that there is a messenger in Mecca. He started asking, he started going to meet people, he started visiting people. What's going to happen? This messenger, who is he? There was one discrepancy. What was the discrepancy? He was in the wrong place. Now, according to the scriptures of the Jewish people, the messenger would have come where there are date palms and the description is of Medina. But why was he in Mecca? That was a question. But then he understood that perhaps he will be persecuted there. Something will drive him to Medina. Always Abdullah ibn Salam, whose name was Al-Hussain ibn Salaam before he accepted Islam, he always had this feeling that I think this is the man, because he calls to one Allah. He's being persecuted by his people. They are calling him names. Normally they call you a madman. They call you a womanizer. Perhaps they call you someone who's interested in wealth. And they have so many different names. So this was something that he always made a dua for. And he was now, after asking questions, convinced that, you know what, that man is definitely the Nabi of Allah. But he was now quite elderly, so he used to make a dua while in his garden, whilst in the synagogue, that, oh Allah, let me meet this man, believe in him, and let me express, show me a sign, a further sign, and let me go beyond this and accept this message. So what happened is, one day he was sitting in his bustan, in his garden. He was sitting in the garden, and his aunt, by the name of Khalida bint al-Harith, she was seated with him and they heard a man call. You know, at that time, the callers used to call, not WhatsApp messages and so on, you know, BBM and it's online suddenly. No. That time, a caller used to call loudly that, hey, this has happened. So the whole village knows that this has happened. Nowadays, still some rural areas, they do this, where someone yells at the top of their voice, hey, this happened, and they walk around and so on. And the village now knows that this has happened. So The man calls and says, "Hey, the messenger of Allah has come. The messenger of Allah has come." And Abdullah ibn Salam was so excited that he said, "Allahu Akbar," loudly. And his aunt was shocked because he's a Jewish man declaring Allahu Akbar upon the arrival of someone who doesn't belong to his faith. So his aunt says, "Wallahi al-Hussain," meaning speaking to the nephew, "it seems like even if the Prophet Moses came, may peace be upon him, you wouldn't have said such a loud Allahu Akbar." So he says, "Indeed, this is the brother of Moses, may peace be upon him. This is the brother of Musa alayhi salam." Now, he used to keep his family members always informed about his findings. So he used to always tell them, "Look, I'm reading about a messenger. He's going to come, inshallah. We will support him. We will be..." So the family was in sync with him. They knew that this man is a very good man. He's a pious man. He helps everyone. He's just. He's respected by all. And he is concerned. He's been looking out for this for many, many years, for decades. So what happened is, subhanAllah, as he declared this and he was so loud and the aunt got so excited and the aunt says, "What is this?" And he says, "This is the brother of Musa alayhi salatu wassalam." So the aunt says, "Now what are you going to do?" He says, "I will just go and make sure it's him. And then I will take it from there." So he says, "Now as I'm proceeding towards the messenger," he's an old man, he's well respected, a very good looking man at the same time, and he's walking towards, very calm, walking towards where the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in Quba. Quba, that initially he had just come into Medina Munawwar. And he says it was so difficult to get near him because there were hundreds of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum around. So who was around him? The Muhajireen who had made Hijrah already were so excited to see Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They went out and they were all around him, greeting, meeting, so on, so forth. And they were trying to contain themselves. In the meantime, the Ansar were from among those of Medina Munawwara who were excited that the visitor came. The one whom we invited has finally come. So it was difficult for this old man to come near. He says, "I stood up at a slightly high position." One narration says he tiptoed a bit and he moved the shoulders of the people to look at the face of this messenger. And he says, "I saw this face and immediately I began to smile." Why? He noticed a calmness in the face. He noticed that this person is really pious. Sometimes we look at someone who's fair in complexion and we say, "Mashallah, there's Noor." But we don't understand Noor is beyond being fair or dark-skinned. You can be very dark and you can have a lot of Noor. And you can be very fair, but you can look devilish or satanic. May Allah protect us. So that is why in the Arabic language, there is a very powerful statement which we all need to know. "Innama ya'rifu dhal fadli minan nasi dhawuhu." What does that mean? A person of virtue is only known by a person of similar virtue. When you have a reciter of the Quran, people will say, "Mashallah, beautiful, lovely." They're talking about his voice. They're talking about his melody. They don't know whether he's a proper reciter. But you get another powerful reciter, he'll tell you, "This man knows how to read. He knows the pronunciation. He knows the qualities of the letters. He knows how to join it." For example, you have a man who can talk to you about medicine. Everyone says, "This is a top doctor." But you can have another one who's a qualified, professional, well-known doctor, powerful results. Those who are intelligent, those who have similar virtue will be able to tell you, "You know what? This person's a really good doctor." This is just an example. Similarly, this man was pious. He was religious. He worshipped one Allah alone all his life. And he was from the Jewish community. He was a really respectable person. So he was also calm and collected. When he saw the face of the messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, immediately he felt a calmness. Calm. You know, some people, you look at them and you feel, "Okay, mashallah, I'm so happy." You know, subhanallah. So what happened is, he says, "I was listening to what this man had to say in order to try and now put two and two together. You know, everything I know and now I'm seeing. Let me just confirm. That's it." So he says, "The first words I heard him say." Now remember, this guy, his father, or should we say, call him a Sahabi? He was not yet a Sahabi, but his father was Salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had it such that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was speaking about a hadith, or he was mentioning words which became a famous narration. It is known as the narration of Abdullah ibn Salam. So Abdullah ibn Salam later on narrates, he says, "The first words I heard from the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, أيها الناس. Calm, very calm, relaxed. O people. أفشو السلام. Spread the salam. The salam here meaning the peace. Spread the goodness. Spread the greeting as well in a genuine fashion. When we say genuine fashion, Assalamu alaikum means may all peace be upon you. May all peace be upon you. Which means you are safe. Subhanallah, you are safe. May peace be upon you. So salam has deep meanings. Very, very deep. That's not our topic tonight. But he says, I heard him say, Afshu salam. Wa at'imu at'am. Feed the people food. Not necessarily only the poor, but feed people, your relatives, and so on. When you feed people, you connect people. You actually relate to people. You begin to become closer to them. People's bellies, for example, are very dear to them, very special to them. So if you have a similar concern for them, they may become closer to you. Subhanallah. Feed the people. So the first words he heard, spread the salam and feed the food. Wasilu al-arhama. Now everything is rhyming. Look at this. Afshu salam wa at'imu at'am wa silu al-arham. Silu al-arham means fulfill your family ties. Make an effort to mend relations. Make an effort to go out and to create a bond where the bonds have been broken between you and family members. Go out. Al-arham referring to those who are related to you to begin with. Go and make amends. Make an effort to go out and develop relations, because it is only common logic that when you have good relations, you have a good concentration when you are praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When your relations are broken, you feel uneasy. You are uneasy when it comes to anything you do or say, especially when it comes to worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have the burden. There are other creatures of Allah. Have a good relationship as far as possible. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy. So this hadith, he continues, he says, وَصِلُوا الْأَرْحَامَ وَصَلُّوا بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامٌ. And fulfill prayer or pray at night when all the people are sleeping. Pray at night when all the people are sleeping. This is speaking to over and above your farad. You know, your duty, your responsibility, your obligatory prayer. This is over and above that. So the hadith says, pray at night when all others are sleeping. Why? Again, it develops a link between you and Allah. No one knows. I'm sitting. I'm praying. Everyone is asleep. Nobody knows. It's me and my maker, my secret. When I meet Allah, you know, I have a smile because he knows something that only I know and he knows. And perhaps the angels who carried it. No one else knows what happened. There must be some secret relation of good deeds between you and Allah. When it's a bad deed, we all want it to be secret. Why don't we have some good deeds that are a secret between you and Allah? How many of us are prepared to do that? A secret. No one knows. You know, Allah knows. That's it. So it's amazing how these were the first words. And at the end, he says, تَدْخُلُوا جَنَّةَ رَبِّكُمْ بِسَلَامٍ. You will enter the Jannah, the paradise of your Lord in peace or with peace. Amazing. So he says, Wallahi, when I looked at his face, I knew it was not the face of a liar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. He says, when I looked at the face of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I knew it was not the face of a liar. And at the same time, I heard his words. I knew that this was revelation. This is not the words of an ordinary man. These are powerful. They are jam-packed with meaning. And he says, I quietly went to him and I declared my shahada straight. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka Muhammad, ashhadu annaka abduhu wa rasuluhu. I bear witness, none worthy of worship besides Allah. You are the messenger of Allah. He asked me, what is your name? I said, Al-Hussain Ibn Salaam. He said, bal anta Abdullah Ibn Salaam. He told him, you are Abdullah ibn Salam. So he says, Wallahi, I have never had a more beloved name to me than Abdullah, given to me by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He loved to use that. So before we end, there is one more beautiful incident that must be mentioned. It must be mentioned. What happened? So Abdullah ibn Salam, when later on it was found out that this man is actually one of the chiefs of the Jews of Medina Munawwara, so Abdullah ibn Salam, according to some narration, he suggested it, and according to another narration, it was suggested by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whatever happened or whatever it was, the occurrence was that Abdullah ibn Salam was told that if you are the head of the Jews, why don't you call them and tell them you accepted Islam? Perhaps they will all accept. He says, "Oh Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, my people, they will not accept. They will not. They have their pride. And because you are not from their family, they won't." You see, family meaning from the children of Ishaq. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam from the children of Ismail. So because you are the children of the cousin, we've got a problem here. May Allah forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. Never reject the truth based on who is bringing it to you. The fact that it is the truth, no matter who it is, it's the truth. It could be your enemy, but he spoke the truth. So basically, Abdullah ibn Salam was hidden in one of the rooms, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called a lot of the Jewish people and asked them, "Who is Al-Hussain ibn Salaam from amongst you?" They said, "He is a leader, a son of our leader, the most knowledgeable, the son of the most knowledgeable." So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "What if he accepted Islam?" So they said, "Never, impossible, he cannot accept Islam. It's out of a question, that will never happen." So he says, "Oh people of this community, fear Allah. Here is the man." He emerged from the rooms and he says, "I have borne witness that there is none worthy of worship besides Allah. This is the messenger we were waiting for, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. None worthy of worship besides Allah, and he is the messenger." You know what they said? Immediately they said, "He's a liar, his father was a liar." Imagine, after years, he's a liar and a cheat, his father is a liar and a cheat. And you know what? He is the worst of us, and his father is the worst of us as well. So he says to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "You see, I told you, these are the people. These are the people. When pride overtakes a person, they reject the truth." I think we have a lesson to learn from that in our own lives, myself included, where we should never ever reject the truth based on pride that might be in our hearts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. Also, what's important for us to know is this man's tongue was always wet with the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was so amused by the Quran that he used to spend whole day with the Quran. He used to read it, love it. He was known as a person who just loved the Quran, and he used to say, "I'm working towards Jannah." And one day the Prophet ﷺ told him, "You are from among those who are in Jannah." He was a very happy man, and he loved the Quran. He used to compare it with what was revealed, and he used to say, "Subhanallah, the Quran has a different sweetness to it." Also, it is reported by Mujahid in his tafsir that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Abdullah ibn Salam in one of the verses, but it's not mentioning his name, but pointing towards him, where the verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَقُولُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَسْتَ مُرْسَلًا. The disbelievers tell you, "O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you are not a messenger." So answer them in the following way. وَيَقُولُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَسْتَ مُرْسَلًا. قُلْ كَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَكُمْ. Tell them, "Allah is sufficient as a witness between you and me." وَمَنْ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ الْكِتَابِ. And the one who has deep knowledge of the book. Referring to whom? Abdullah ibn Salam, according to the tafsir of Mujahid. According to the other Mufassirin, there is a different meaning to it. But it's interesting that Allah says, "Allah is a witness between you and them, and the one who has deep knowledge of the book, he's also a witness." May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding. It's reported that he passed away in Medina Munawwara, and some narrations say he passed away in Ash-Sham. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us a beautiful lesson. His family members all accepted Islam, but the community did not. Later on, there were skirmishes between the Jewish people and the Muslimin. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all a lesson. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.